lecture on diabetes mellitus in the humans. Diabetes mellitus as diabetes mellitus, commonly called just diabetes, refers to a clinical syndrome of hyperglycemia occurring due to deficiency of insulin. It has two types mainly. Type 1 diabetes is the insulin-dependent diabetes mellitus because of inadequate insulin secretions, and type 2 is relative lack of response by the target tissue cells to insulin, and it is non-insulin-dependent diabetes mellitus. Type 1 diabetes mellitus is low level of insulin occurs in it, and 10% of the diabetes cases are of this type. In IDDM, patients receive insulin injections as a treatment purpose through subcutaneous route of administration. In type 1 or insulin dependent diabetes mellitus, because of the destruction of the beta cells of pancreas by the antibodies, so it is the autoimmune destruction of the beta cells which lead to deficiency of the insulin synthesis as well as secretions of the insulin. So this is the insulin dependent diabetes mellitus. No doubt the genetic susceptibility and major determinant, while environmental factors also act as a trigger for the diabetes patient. So diabetes mellitus as type 1 diabetes, it usually develops before the age of 40, so it is called as juvenile diabetes. Patients with this disease are not obese as they have a high incidence of ketosis as well as acidosis, and these are the type 1 beta cells destroyed, no insulin is produced, so it is just like a stage of chronic fasted state or melting flesh. It occurs in this ketosis, acidosis, glycosuria, diuresis and coma. Second type of diabetes is the type 2 diabetes mellitus, and it is known as non-insulin dependent diabetes mellitus. 90% of diabetic cases are of this type of patients, and in this there is a genetic disorder because in this the family history plays strong positive role in these type of patients. It's supposed to occur due to decrease in insulin receptors on the insulin responsive cells, as well as insulin resistance tissue is produced. That the tissue on which the insulin acts, for example on the adipose tissue or on the muscle, they become inactive or do not give response to the action of insulin. So predisposing factor is main is the hereditary, which plays strong positive correlation with the diabetic patients. Second is the obesity. In type 2 diabetes mellitus patients, if the BMI is more than 30, that persons are considered as obese. So in obese person, the adipose tissues are usually resistant to the actions of insulin as compared to the non-obese persons. So in obese person, there occur a hyperinsulinemia along with dyslipidemia, that is high level of circulating free fatty acids along with the low HDL. So it is along with low HDL, it is called as metabolic syndrome or syndrome X, and these patients are more prone for the type 2 diabetes mellitus to produce. So in this condition, load on the beta cell is so much increased to produce more insulin, ultimately lead to exhaustion of the beta cells and resulting in precipitation of diabetes in obese persons. So type 2 diabetes mellitus is the defect also in some patients in the identified genes. So in majority onset diabetes, it occurs in young individuals. So this is also known as MODY, that is majority onset of diabetes in youngs, which occurs in 1% cases of the type 2 diabetes mellitus. And this is because of the loss of function mutations, which have been described in 6 different genes, and it is present. For example, defect in the glucokinase enzyme. If the mutation occurs in glucokinase, we know this enzyme is used to convert glucose into glucose 6-phosphate. So that can't be occur if there occur a mutation in glucokinase. So further secretion of insulin can't be possible in those persons. Second, if the gene defective in the insulin molecule itself or the gene which formed insulin receptor, that may be having mutations, or GLUT4 transporters having mutations, so no glucose utilization occurs in the muscle or in the adipose tissue. Insulin receptor substrate is may be mutated. So these are the various genes which occur in type 2 diabetic mellitus that may be mutated or defective. So type of diabetes mellitus, it may be further divided in another categories as primary, secondary diabetes. Primary is which cause is not exactly known. It may be a, for example, type 1 insulin dependent diabetes mellitus or type 2, that is non-insulin dependent diabetes mellitus. Secondary diabetes mellitus is associated with certain pathological conditions as pancreatitis, cystic fibrosis, where occur thick mucus causing scarring of the pancreas and lead to decreased insulin secretions. Acromegaly, because of increase of growth hormone secretion, diabetes is precipitated, and also the Cushing syndrome, in which more cortisol secretions lead to precipitation of diabetes. Another diabetes is also that is known as gestational diabetes, which is also known as pregnancy-induced diabetes mellitus. Now, the characteristic feature of the type 2 or non-insulin dependent diabetes mellitus, it is manifest after the 40 years of age, so it is also called as adult onset diabetes. It is most common and account for 90% of diabetic population. Mostly patients are obese. The symptoms which begin in these patients are gradual and may be ignored sometime. If it is diagnosed, it is diagnosed from the urine examination, because normally in the urine the glucose is nil. But if the glucose is positive in the urine examination, that is glycosuria is present, then patient is diagnosed as a diabetic. And plasma insulin levels are often normal or even sometimes elevated in non-insulin dependent diabetes mellitus patients. But ketoacidosis is not very common. Because this is common, or acetone breath, ketoacidotic type symptoms are more common in type 1 diabetes mellitus patients. So, a serious disorder of carbohydrate metabolism resulting from the hyposecretion or hypoactivity of insulin. Three cardinal signs in diabetes is polyuria, huge urine output, polydipsia, excessive thirst, and polyphagia, that is the excessive hunger and food consumption. So, most common, it is 10% in type 1 and 90% type 2 cases are present in diabetic population. Chronic complication lead to atherosclerosis, and further they may lead to renal failure, blindness. So many complications are occurring because of diabetics. Now, these are, in this slide, there are two curves. One curve, this blue curve is showing the normal glucose tolerance curve in the normal subjects, while the upper one, red, is the curve of the diabetic subjects, and in between level, these are the impaired glucose tolerance curves, or the level of the impaired glucose tolerance patient. Now, this slide again shows that if we give 75 gram glucose to the patient, initial its fasting level is below 100 milligram per deciliter, but after taking glucose, its level postprandial raise up to 140 milligram. But again goes back to normal even below the baseline. But in case of diabetic patient, initial fasting level is around 140 milligram or 126 milligram per deciliter. And after taking oral glucose around about 75 gram, these levels raise to 200 milligram per deciliter, and they will remain even more than 2 for so long time. But in normal subject, these level reaches even below the baseline after 2 hours. So this is the difference between the glucose tolerance test in the normal subjects and in diabetic patients. These are the levels of the plasma glucose concentration fasting level in normal subjects, in impaired glucose tolerance, and also in diabetic patients. And these below is the postprandial level of blood glucose less than 140 milligram in normal, and it is more than 200 or equal to 200 milligram per deciliter in diabetic patient, but in between levels are of impaired glucose tolerance stress. Now, in the symptoms of the diabetic mellitus patients, it is the hyperglycemia, main because of increase of blood glucose level. There occur polyuria, polydipsia, polyphagia, that are the three cardinal symptoms of the diabetic patients. Ketoacidosis, especially most that is common in insulin-dependent diabetic mellitus patients. There occur a hyperlipidemia, muscle wasting, that is more and more protein catabolism occurs and which lead to depletions of the protein. Electrolyte depletion occur because electrolytes are lost in the urine. So frequent urination, excessive thirst, blurred vision, extreme fatigue, increased hunger, as well as weight loss, and the especially the sensation of pain and peripheral neuropathy creates the sensation of pain and needles in the feet. So this is basically on the sole of the foot, these type of sensation which is known as peripheral neuropathy that appears in diabetic patients because of the loss of the or degeneration of the sensory as well as motor neurons in diabetic patients. So hyperglycemia we know because of elevation of blood glucose concentration in diabetic patients or uncontrolled diabetes mellitus, and it occurs because of lack of insulin. So we know the action of insulin, so it is decreased, that is decreased peripheral utilization of glucose, increased hepatic output of glucose through gluconeogenesis as well as glycogenolysis, so more blood glucose levels are present in diabetic patients. Glycosuria, as increase of blood glucose level even rises above the renal threshold point, that is above 180 milligram per deciliter, and we know glucose is a osmotically active particle, it lead to increase more excretion in the urine, and along with urine glycosuria, so this is known as glycosuria, that is excretion of glucose into the urine occurs and lead to polyuria, excessive large amount of urine, result of osmotic diuresis, which is caused by renal excretion of osmotically active glucose molecules, and because along with water, so many electrolytes are also lost in the urine as sodium, potassium and phosphate. High glucose concentration increases the osmotic pressure of the extracellular fluid, and because of that, the cellular dehydration is started in the diabetic patient because osmotic transfer of water occurs from inside the cell to the ECF and lead to dehydration in the cells. Also lead to increased calorie loss as a result of loss of glucose in the urine. Polydipsia occurs because of excessive loss of urine. The thirst mechanism is activated because of excessive loss of water in the urine along with glucose, then thirst mechanism is activated and excessive drinking of water result and which further lead to cellular dehydration. The third very important cardinal sign is polyphagia, that is the excessive eating occurs due to, here you can write, decreased stimulation of the striatal center, not increase, it is the decreased stimulation of the striatal center which lead to polyphagia. It is clear that ventromedian nucleus of hypothalamus, no doubt brain do not require insulin for glucose utilization, but the striatal center in the hypothalamus, that is definitely stimulated if insulin is present. But if insulin is deficient, this center is not stimulated. So because of the decreased stimulation of striatal center, which will produce inhibition on feeding center, definitely that inhibition has gone. And so this feeding center remain excited all the time, which is the lateral hypothalamus present in the lateral hypothalamic region of the hypothalamus, which is known as feeding center, that is remain stimulated because of deficiency of insulin. So there occur polyphagia in diabetic patients. But no doubt increase food intake, still there occur a loss of body weight because glucose is not utilized by the body. So loss of calories occurs in the urine and mobilization of fats and protein, especially muscle proteins, are utilized for energy production. So there occur myopathies and their muscle weakness and their occur because of more and proteins are degraded or catabolized in the amino acids, so they occur negative nitrogen balance in the body and loss of body weight occur because of all these metabolism. So loss of body weight in spite of excessive food intake in the diabetics, this is known as starvation in the midst of plenty. Impaired phagocytic function occur because of hyperglycemia. All the steps in phagocytosis that is impaired by the increased blood glucose level, and because of that the chance of infection that is more in diabetic patients as compared to non-diabetic persons. Hypersmolar effects start because of continuous increase of glucose in the blood lead to hypersmolarity in the blood, which may even over 375 millismoles per kg. And because of this hypersmolar effect, definitely there occur dehydration in the central nervous system and leading to impairment of the cerebral function. And when the cerebral function start appearing, ultimately there occur hyperosmolar coma that is precipitated in diabetic patients because of hyperosmolarity in the blood. So this is the summarized in the diabetes patient ki definitely these three target tissues are affected, liver, adipose tissues and skeletal muscle, and lead to hyperglycemia as well as lipidemia and ketoacidosis occurs, with three cardinal signs: polyuria, polydipsia, polyphagia, and acetone breath specially present in the type 1 diabetes mellitus along with the Kussmaul's breathing, that is the rapid and deep breathing which appears. So acute complications of diabetes is in type 1 and type 2, one is hyperglycemia, glycosuria, polyuria and cellular dehydration. Insulin glucagon molar ratio is going to be decreased in type 1, lead to ketogenesis, ketoacidosis and ketone bodies start appearing in the urines, electrolyte imbalance and rapid and deep breathing which is known as Kussmaul's breathing appear in the diabetic patients. And this Kussmaul's breathing is also known as because of the diabetic ketoacidosis. In addition, the chronic complication of diabetic patient that is because of the amyloid products. These amyloid products are formed when the glucose level is increased in the blood for a so long time, they will start combining with the proteins, especially the cross-linked matrix proteins, and they form the advanced glycosylated end products. No doubt these also lead the patient towards aging, which you have already studied in aging. This is one of the theory of aging. Advanced glycosylated end products definitely lead the person towards aging, and also these products cause the damage of the blood vessels and lead to the complication because of damage of microcirculation or microvasculature in the various organs, especially in the retina, in the nephrons, also in the various sensory and motor nerves. So this also lead to diabetic nephropathy, diabetic retinopathy and diabetic neuropathy because of these glycosylated products which is formed by glycosylation of the tissue proteins. So diabetes sometimes complicated by acidosis, coma and long standing diabetes, additional complication occurs, which I have just told to you. These may be microvascular complications because of the advanced glycosylated related products. These complications may be macrovascular because of the increased atherosclerosis in the large blood vessels because of hyperlipidemia, and these further lead to various neuropathic disorders. So diabetic retinopathy basically occurs because of hard exudate, they settle down on the retina, causes scarring of the retina, and hard exudate further lead to blindness in diabetic patient, even lead to diabetic nephropathy which further lead to renal failure. And if there occur a sensory and motor nerve degeneration, it lead to diabetic neuropathy and or also known as peripheral neuropathies. Macrovascular abnormalities because of accelerated atherosclerosis is secondary to increase in level of low density lipoprotein. So it is because of hyperlipidemia, and it results in increased incidence of stroke that is the cerebrovascular accidents which occurs and lead even to paralysis in the patients, and also there occur a myocardial infarction because of increase of atherosclerosis in the large vessels. Diabetic neuropathy involves the autonomic nervous system and peripheral nerves, which I have already told to you. Now, reduced resistance to infection lead to chronic ulceration, more common in diabetic patient, which further lead in even gangrene of the feet, and especially that is named as a gangrene of the diabetic feet. Chronic complication of diabetes, so narrowing of the large vessels lead to macrovascular complications, and advanced glycosylated related products lead to microvascular lesions. So ultimately there occur in sensory dysfunction, loss of feeling of the lower limb, ANS dysfunction, gastrointestinal tract is affected, bladder dysfunctions occur, even impotency is also common in diabetic patients. Now diagnosis of the diabetes mellitus, it is done by the urine examination, for example black glycosuria, that depends upon the renal threshold level, no doubt this is the disadvantage. Second is the urine examination for the ketone bodies is done as a for the diagnosis of diabetic patient. Third important diagnostic test is the fasting level, as well as postprandial blood glucose level should be monitored, and we know normally 70 to 110 milligram per deciliter, and postprandial blood glucose level is less than 140 milligram per deciliter in the normal subject, but in the diabetic patient these levels are increased. Glucose tolerance test should be done, that we have already discussed with you. The curve of the diabetic patient is definitely deranged from the normal levels in normal persons. Glycosylation hemoglobin is also very important test to detect the about the diabetes, because we know in normally 3 to 5% of the total hemoglobin, that is glycosylated hemoglobin, which is present in our blood. But in diabetic patient, this glycosylated hemoglobin level, it is increased to 10 to 20% of the total hemoglobin. So its level is up to the 10 to 20% of total hemoglobin. So in diabetic patient, definitely these levels are more. So determination of glycosylated hemoglobin has become an important tool for the monitoring of the diabetic control. So in the treatment of the diabetic patients, in the theory of treatment for type 1 diabetes mellitus, we know it is because of destruction of beta cells of pancreas and the insulin secretions are decreased, or synthesis of insulin is decreased. So for the treatment in type 1 diabetes, it is always preferred to administer enough insulin to the patient so that metabolism become normal as well as possible, and this insulin administration is mostly given to the patient through subcutaneous route of administration. Insulin preparation, they are fall in three categories: rapid acting, intermediate acting, and long acting insulin preparations. Detail of these preparations you will definitely study in the pharmacology in next year. Now the treatment in type 2 diabetes mellitus, first is the preventive measures, as we advise the patient to take low calorie diet, so that dietary precaution should be first advised to the patients. Second is the advise the patient to do regular exercise, so that with these two precautions at least the decrease of weight loss should be occur. So induce weight loss by these two advice, reverse the insulin resistance of the various target tissues where the insulin act. But if still fails, if the blood glucose levels do not come to the normal in these patient with these two precautions, then always advise the patient to take oral hypoglycemic drugs, so that to increase the insulin sensitivity and also to stimulate the increased production of insulin by the pancreas. So oral hypoglycemic drugs are given, especially for example sulfonylurea, and I have already discussed with you the action of sulfonylurea. It will act on the beta cells of pancreas, especially in the on the potassium channels, where it will act just like the ATP sensitive inhibitory potassium channels. So block the potassium channels so that insulin secretion should be increased, by giving these oral hypoglycemic drugs to the diabetic patients. So with this, I finish my all the lectures.